It's the end of May 2020. A lot of excitement going on today. First of all, there's a cougar roaming around the neighborhood. So, as I like to say, as I told all the neighbors, everything I write, it comes true. The next thing of excitement is today was a spray day in the vineyard. So, was up early this morning outside spraying, and it stopped working right when it needs to be done. A broken battery. So a lot of drama today. Got about half of it done. That being the case, we found 6 bottles of blush wine. Blush wine to see us through the pandemic, hoping there will be a glass or a bottle left until we meet again. In any event, after half a spray day today, half a bottle of blush wine is well deserved. No need to talk about the rest of the events going in the world. Suffice it to say, I can't breathe, and I think we've all had enough of that. This is chapter 15. It's Raising Canes, and it takes place after the vineyard is planting, so it's kind of a description of what happens next. Let's get started. Raising Canes. Digging holes are the contractions of a vineyard's birth, an arduous task alone, but in a group, your efforts are multiplied and your vineyard is born. As with delivery of a child, planting a vineyard is just as hard, intense, and fulfilling. And, like running a marathon, it feels good when you stop. But the vines don't stop. They are the consummation of longing, lust, and love. And like the nascence of a newborn, it's just the beginning. Enjoy the honeymoon. Bask in your accomplishment. You should be proud. Invite friends and neighbors to share your joy. She must be suckled, diapers changed, food prepared, schools found and funded, vaccinated, illness and fevers fought. Children are fragile, yet so robust. Ah, the joys of parenthood. As for your partner, will you love each other a year from now, as much as today? Of course. Love is strong. Love never fades. And will you love each other in 5 years, as much as today? And 10 years later? Wedding days and vineyard planting parties are opening ceremonies of a lifelong journey till death do us part. Couples who make wine together stick together. Alas, some marriages crash on the rocks, succumbing to the songs of a Lorelei, who woos the unwary to real or spiritual death. While romance is fickle, for lucky couples it endures and may grow with the passage of time. Vineyards always grow and demand your attention. Do you have the will to keep up? Can you keep up? Ah, the vines, look at them. Now they have me singing a song. I'm so glad I didn't plant a vineyard. I could just walk down the road and visit Joe, Matt, Carrie Ann, or Sheila anytime, get my vineyard fixed, and leave with as much wine as I could carry. With the vines in the ground, the next objective was to get them to grow. When Sheila woke the morning after the vineyard blessing, she shrieked when she walked outside and saw the vine stripped bare. Pa thought she had been cornered by the dead snake's mate. They covered each vine with a protective grow tube, purchasing ones that could be fastened and easily opened to thin extra shoots and inspect the tube for menacing snails. Within weeks, shoots sprouted from the rootstock's grafted notch, rising up and above the plastic tubes, and Paul observed red and white polka-dotted ladybugs, and another bug, shaped like a frog's flat nose with wings. He had found his first sharpshooter, and panic set in as he hadn't inoculated his vines. Fortunately, he only saw a few of the Pierce's disease vectors the first summer, and his vineyard was spared, or seemed to be. The sharpshooters roosted in the neighbor's orange grove, waiting for the vines to grow. The honeymooners joyfully walked from vine to vine, unfastened each grow tube, and, like pulling suckers from a tomato plant, pinched excess shoots from the young vines, funneling growth to the 3 strongest shoots showing the most potential. Some growers thinned the baby vines to 1 or 2 shoots, but Ball felt it was a good idea to leave a spare for the times he accidentally broke a shoot. Whoops! Or 2. Shit! And the spare became the last great hope of that toddler vine. The first year's goal is to promote strong root growth and structure with long waterings that allow water to seep deep so roots stretch for it. You could even let the vines grow wild year one, not thinning shoots at all, because the shoots above ground mirror shoots underground. Carrie Anne chose to tape her longer shoots to the waist-high wire to establish a cordon after thinning the vine to two or three shoots. All the wine growers here pluck off any grape buds the first year, so the vine's energy is not wasted on fruit production. The following winter, when pruning vines gone wild, select the stronger shoot that's now a hardened cane. Cut away everything else except that one cane and prune it back to two or three buds above the graft. In spring, new shoots will emerge with amazing vigor that can be trained to the wire to form cordons. You can train the vine with one cordon arm or two. The advantage of one arm is the vine's plumbing is unobstructed. There's a direct path from the ground through the trunk to the cordon. With two cordon arms per vine, there's a Y, where the vine splits with less energy going to each arm. On the other hand, maybe you want two cordon arms to control vigor, or for aesthetic preferences. It's never simple when it comes to vines. No right answer, ever. The correct answer is, it depends. If you're growing free-range vines, you don't need to train new shoots to a cordon wire. Prune it like a rose. And to help new shoots survive, tie a few of them to a pole to keep them above rabbits or whatever critter menaces your tender green shoots. Wine growers aiming to produce wine the second leaf will lay down the stronger shoot as a one-arm cordon. With the cordon established year one, they'll make wine the second. I toured a vineyard in Ramona and drank wine made from their second leaf grapes, and as Lum would say, it washed the pasta down pretty good. If that's your goal, the key is to plant early so you get a full year's growth in that first year. When Paul and Sheila pruned that first winter, he suggested they cut back the weaker vines to two buds to start over. One step back, two steps forward, he said, it's the dance of life. Don't ruin my dream, she said, I want cordons, now. So they ended up with vines with weaker arms that weren't productive until the third year. Still, it all worked out. The vines know what to do. After they planted their second batch of vines and pruned them all the way back to two buds, leaving one spare, Paul was astonished at the strength of the trunks and the cordons from taking one step back, pruning, to move two steps forward. It also helped they planted the second batch of vines in February instead of May. He learned many vineyard lessons the hard way. If first-year vines are infants, second-leaf vines have entered elementary school. Girls in colorful dresses dance ring around the rosy. Daddy, let's play, she calls. Mommy, can you braid my pigtails? Mommy, I'm thirsty, says another. Boys dressed in Little League uniforms playing baseball, imitating swings of players they imagine becoming. Dad, want to play catch? A young boy calls. Mom, can you bring me a soda? Don't even get me started about the punk vines with their crazy haircuts. Wait, there goes a six-year-old boy in lederhosen in America. A retro vine? Where did he come from? Ich heiße Gewürztraminer. Over there, a young vine is crying. What's the matter? My parents are leaving. Don't worry, they'll be back. They have things to do. But the young vine is worried, and the spirit of this vine runs, 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 and catches up to his parents already in the car, and he knocks on the window and pleads, don't go, don't go, don't go. Dad says, we'll be back soon. As the car pulls ahead, the vine cries, no, 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 I want to go with you, and cast out long tendrils, wrapping them around the car's door. And as the car moves farther away, the vine extends. And when the vine can stretch no more, tendrils snap, leaving rings of bonds around the handle that harden into wood, tying a knot forever. Later that evening, the parents return, their vine tucked in bed. And at dawn, the parents, refreshed, walk to their children to greet them with the rising sun and give thanks to the good earth for their blessings. All the children are happy and begin to play, and the parents walk through the schoolyard, calling each vine by name. What's the matter, dear? I had a nightmare. I saw a monster with long, sharp teeth trying to bite my feet. There, there, don't worry. I'll catch him and take him to a better place. How did your parents clothe you as a child? A dress, jeans, cutoffs, hand-me-downs from older siblings, shopping trips to the mall, a dress cut from drapes your mom pulled from windows, clothes sewn from rags. Look over there, beyond the boy in lederhosen. girls and boys in front of flat screens, tapping computer code, programming school projects. "Mom, how do I get out of this continuous loop?" she asks. "Dad, help me get rid of this bug." Children, growing like weeds, growing like vines, their thirst for knowledge, their pureness of heart, their cuteness, their innocence, no digital divide, no homework gap, a level playing field, all vines created equal. There are clones, after all. But is it a level growing field? What about those vines over there, planted above a plot of volcanic bedrock hidden beneath the soil? They'll struggle, 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 their roots pushing against solid rock, blocked, unable to breathe through the break through the barrier. Children, ever so resilient, their innate will to survive. Reach, stretch, extend beyond the barrier in search of water and nutrition. And if they survive, won't they be stronger from their struggles and produce the best tasting fruit? The good farmer walks down the rows, looking at each vine, and when she hears a cry for help, for food, for protection, how can she refuse her child? When fat fog or misty drizzle floats in at night, drops of water weigh down young vines, and the good farmer, with her faithful companion trotting ahead, searches and binds up the fallen. Spring turns to summer, summer to fall, then winter, and the good farmer spreads compost around each vine to absorb winter rains and gently release nutrients. It's the third leaf, adolescence, high school. The 16-year-old wants to drive. The third leaf vine is driven to procreate, to bear grapes. You can't stop nature's urges. Paul and Sheila made plans to make the first wines with their grapes, an estate vintage. The third year after they planted, May turned into June, and the U.S. Open Championship and Tiger Woods arrived in San Diego. So Paul, who no longer had time to golf, decided to take time off from work and the vineyard to watch in person with friends as they witnessed Tiger roar back to force a playoff. An elite platoon of white microbes parachuted into his vineyard, and as weather warmed the next day, Tiger claimed the title, and the microbes became more numerous than fans at Torrey Pines. The next morning, as Paul walked past the spot where the vineyard consultant with the $1,500 a day bobcat said, "You won't need to spray here," he noticed a slight dusting of snow between green grape buds. He had never seen powdery mildew, but soon became a mini expert. If only he had donned his mask and spray pack on June 6 to honor the memory of D-Day combatants instead of going to the U.S. Open, he could have saved half his grapes. If only he had hired a vineyard manager to keep an eye on everything. If only he hadn't been so lazy. Of course you need to spray a vineyard. What was he thinking? It was a great victory for Tiger and the mildew guys, and a terrible defeat for the vines. Never again. Vow Paul, never again.